Okay, let's start. Is my screen visible?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Thank you. Today we will look at operators, the way they are defined. We primarily look at mathematical operators, logical operators, relational operators, conditional operators, increment, and so on and so forth, and get into some minor fine tweaking of these operators. Whenever you do any operator, that basically means you are performing some operation. An operation has to be performed on some entity. In our C case, those entities can either be numbers or variables or what we call as literals. So we look at what the literals are, then detailed list of operators such as arithmetic, assignment operators, the different form of assignment operators, relational and logical operators, increment, decrement, and I have often seen confusion in using this increment and decrement operators. Then we do bitwise operators, then some special operators, and time permitting, we discuss operator precedence, but we're limited to basic precedence between arithmetic operators. And how does type conversion happen? Some detailed list of char to integer or integer to long, and so on, so forth. So let's look at, when we talking of operators, they operate on certain values. Those values could be a constant, or those values could be defined by a variable. As you said, variable is the one that can vary the value during the life of the program. A constant is a value that cannot change during the execution of the program. So these constants in C language are known as what is called literal. Now you have a string literals, that is set of characters. You have a character literals. You have integer and floating point literals. Integer literals come in different form. Let's say I say number 66. Number 66 is decimal number 66. And that is what we write. If any decimal, any integer number, we start writing with zero, because leading zero does not indicate any value. So in C, if we start writing a number zero, this represents octal representation. So that means this is a base 8. So if I look at base 8, this value would become, this is 8 power 0, this is 8 power 1, this is 8 power 2. So the value would be 8 power 2 into 1 plus 8 power 1 into 0 plus 8 power 0 into 2, and thus the number would become 66.
Yeah.
So whether we write the number x is equal to 66, or we write x is equal to 0, 1, 0, 2, then it is called the octal notation, and that's what we do. If you want to write an hexadecimal notation, hexadecimal as base 16, so this could be written as 0x42, this is unit value 16 power 0, this is 16 power 1, 16 power 1 into 4, which is 64. The 16 power 0 into 2, this again becomes 66. It depends upon how long we would like a value to hold the variable. So if you were to write integer value indicating that it is a long, then we can say 66L. Suffixing L would become a long. Suffixing with U makes it an unsigned, and this makes it unsigned U long. When you make it a U, it becomes unsigned, and one has to be little careful how to use that. For example, if I were to show you, let's say, I declare int x is equal to minus 1 u. Now, I say print percentage dx. What do you think value printed would be? Any thoughts? I'm saying minus 1 u, this is unsigned. So what is the value would be printed? Will it be minus 1? Will it be something else? Since we said u unsigned, it will convert it to positive value, and if we run, it displays this, but if I were to put in as minus u here, you will basically get the value as unsigned value with the respective value. So it depends upon how you want to present, and that's how the value would basically be taken. So depending on how do you take, if I were to say, let's say unsigned print x, and then I print it, even though I'm saying minus 1 u, when you print it, it still be positive, which is 2 raised to power 32 minus 1. So one has to be a little careful when using the sign notations, and same way. In floating point, we have two types in the literals. We can basically say the simple floating point, like value of pi, or we can represent them in scientific notation, that is decimal number and 10 raised to power, whatever that is. So 10 raised to power minus 1, L. L is indicating it is a long, having more precision there. We can also write character constants. So when you write in single quote, it is represented as character, and depending on how to use it, value taken would be the respective integer value or ASCII value. For example, let me indicate that, let's say, I were to say, now, when you put characters in the literal in a single quote, it becomes a constant, and it bit depends upon the ASCII value. So character capital A has a hex code of 0x41, and small a and the hex code of 0x61. So when the values are taken, they'll be taken either as integer or depending on how to represent. So even though look at character A, they actually would be stored as 65 and 97. But if you were to print in character 4% C, you basically see in capital A and small. And we run this program, then you can see that. I had the error, sorry, one more. Okay, thanks. So you see this x, when I represent as integer, it is displayed with 65, so that the hex notation, y is small a in ASCII table, If you want to look at what the ASCII values are, you can actually go to ASCII table and look at the value. You can see ASCII value. So capital A has a value X 41, decimal 65, octal notation, the base set is 101. Similarly, if you look at small a would be X 61, decimal 97, and so on, so forth. So you have to understand and use these values appropriately. We already seen some script characters, such as want to go to new line, you can put a new line character either as part of a string or as part of a single character, that will be new line. And similarly, tab, the display part is single quote backslash t, and that's how, so look at that's how the literals are represented, the integer. So these are all numbers on which we can operate mathematically, do some computation. There are alphabetic literals on which we cannot do mathematical computation, but can be used as stored as a text. So anything which is stored as a text, simple text written part, those are called string literals. As we saw, hello, or hello. So now, because I have a new line character here, so it will print it in two lines, hello and how are you. The string literals, if we put two string literals together, dear space students, this would be taken as concatenated, students will be added to this, there's no syntax error, and this will also work fine. Actually, you get a string as dear students. How do you define constants in the programming languages? There are two ways of defining it. One is via using a struct called preprocessor call hash define. If you get into more details on preprocessor part towards the end, I can say 100 and value is 100. So now whenever I use this 100 part, it will always mean 100. So whenever in a C program you write 100 in this way, it will always take a value of whatever is the next value. This has to be separated by string. I can also say KSIT as a string literal, diplomatic literal, specify that wherever I say capital KSIT, it actually would mean this string here. Sometimes you want to define individual values as variable, but say these are constant. For example, you are passing some parameter to the function. You do not want that function something to modify the value. So we can prefix something called a constant. This means even though X is a variable in the program, X cannot be changed in the program. If you try to change it, your compiler will probably give an error saying I'm trying to change the constant value. So that's the way you can define integer constant. For example, let's say if I were to do that, constant in X, and let's say I try to modify X is equal to 101, 102. Now, because int is a constant, I'll get an error here, so I'm trying to change the value of X. You see the error saying assignment read only because X is going to be a constant, so you cannot assign a value to the X. What is the differentiate? So by declaring with the const any variable, that becomes my integer constant. Next, we look at the operators we have seen. We know that arithmetic operators, plus is for subtraction, plus is for addition, dash or minus for subtraction, star is used for multiplication, slash is for division. If both the operands are integer, it will be integer division. If one of them is float, then it will become a floating point division. And there are other operators called percentage, which is the remainder. We are very comfortable with when everything is positive integer. But when any of those divisor or the number we are dividing from, dividend, is a negative, the implementation depends upon the language, different language implement different. In C, when you divide, if both are same signs, the result would be positive. For example, minus 10 by minus 3, both are same signs, my answer would be 3 integer division. But if anything is, one of them is negative, one of them is positive, then you have to see that even the division sign would be negative, but how the remainder would be. And how the remainder is decided is following the Euclidean equation that we can write any number integer p as b into q plus r, where b is another integer, q is the quotient, and r is remainder. If we take the divided value, the quotient, multiply by the divisor, so take the quotient, multiply by the divisor, add it the remainder, then you get the right answer. So if we look at this, what is that we should be getting the answer? So let's look at run them. I would say minus 10 and this is minus 10 by 3. So first is I'm doing integer division, second I'm doing is the remainder. Now let me run it and see with different answers. All this gives you minus 3, this gives you 3, because both of them are negative. This again gives you minus 3, because one is negative and positive. And you look at 10% is minus 3, remainder, you are getting remainder as 1 and not as minus 1, mainly because it satisfies the Euclidean equation, indicating that my minus 3, when I say multiply minus 3 into my divisor minus 3, that becomes plus 9, plus 9, plus remainder. So when I follow the Euclidean equation, my answer would be 10, and this is what I should be getting. In this case, my answer is minus 1, because when I minus 3 into 3 gives you minus 9, plus minus 1 get minus 10, and so on and so forth. So one has to be very clear about what do you really get? So let's say if I were to change it a little bit. So let me go to the slides, it will be easier. I would like to make you guess what would the answer be for the first case, for the second case, and for the third case. -20 integer division -3, -20 integer division -3, -20 integer division -3, and the respective percentages. Guys, give it a try. Who would like to answer? Aditi, Amrita, Rajat to respond. Nabiha, what would be 20 divided by minus 3? Apeksha, are you guys there?
Yes, sir.
Let me answer Apeksha, what would be 20 integer divided by minus 3? What would the answer be? 20 divided by minus 3, 20 remainder minus 3. Chetan, Chirag, you guys should be able to respond. GC Sambram, Sai Neha, nobody wants to respond. We're talking simple mathematics division. We're talking class 4. So do not give me the argument your biology students so you don't know. Arshita, guys, you don't respond, I'm going to mark you absent now onwards. Meet means with the sign in and go away. Hemant,
sir, is it minus 6?
Yes, answer would be minus 6. What about the remainder?
Sir, 2 is the remainder.
Should be 2 or should be minus 2?
Minus 2, sir.
20 by minus 3. Should be 2 or should be minus 2? Remainder would follow the sign of first operator. Remember, because it is minus 6, so if the signs are different, my quotient would basically be negative. It becomes minus 6. And if the equation is P is equal, dividend is equal to the quotient into divisor, divisor into quotient plus remainder. Now we know that quotient is your minus 6, B, and then B is your minus 3, so it becomes 18 plus 2 should make it 20, so remainder should be 2. When I divide by minus 3, my remainder should be 2. What about second case? Minus 20 by 3. And minus 20% is 3.
Plus 6.
Minus 20, so question is minus 20 by 3.
Sir, it's minus your 6.
Answer will be minus 6. What about the remainder?
Minus 2.
Yes, because first operand is minus, it will minus 2, and again you can use your Euclidean equation. Because my quotient is minus 6 into 3 becomes minus 18. So I need to add minus 2 to make it minus 20. So remainder would be minus 2. In third case, minus 20 divided by minus 3. What is my answer would be? Give me an answer. What about remainder?
Minus 2.
So that makes you clear how does remainder with negative number works. And I can assure you a lot of times you get confused. It has to be very clear how does the remainder with negative divisions work. Then we have the assignment operator. We know to assign the values. You can say x is equal to 10, x is equal to 5, x is equal to x plus y, meaning whatever the value of x is, add the value of y to it, and that becomes the new value of x. If I'm using the existing value of x in many mathematical operations, as a shortcut, you can use something called a plus equal to. When I write x plus equal to y, this indicates x is equal to x plus y. Similarly, with multiplication, I can write x star equal to y, meaning x is equal to x star y, the shortened notations, and same we want to look at. But when I write like this, you have to be a little careful what I'm writing. It basically means x is equal to x into x plus y. So whatever the right side is, whole thing is to be taken, multiplied by x, and then assign the value. You have to practice those, and that's the way things are going to work. You need to do a lot of practice in there. One major confusion happens in what is called increment operator. The increment operator is increment integer value by 1, but decrement is 2 dash dash, decrement value by 1. They come in two forms. One is called post increment and pre increment. The same is the case for post decrement and pre decrement. What does that mean is, let's say x is equal to 100 and y is 200. And let's say x is equal to y plus 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 1. So this is the post increment operator. That means while computing the value of x, let me repeat again, when computing the value of x, use the existing value of y. And after the value of y is used, computing x, then increment it. So at this point, if I were to print the value of x, x would become y's value 200. I'll take the 200 value, 200 plus 1. So x would be 200 plus 1, and x would be 201, and y would be 201. So if we look at after this statement, I use the value of y, which becomes 200. Add 1 to it, that becomes 201. So x will be 201. And because I'm incrementing y after using it, y also becomes 201. After this statement, both x and y becomes 201. Now this is pre-increment operator. That means first increment the value of y and then use it. So here if we look at after this, both x and y have become 201. Here I am saying increment the value of y first, and then use it in the computation. So y is 201, y becomes 202. I use the value 202, add 1 to it, so x becomes 203. What is then the difference again? Post increment means use the value of the variable in the expression computation, and after it is computed, only then increment the value of the operand. So after value of y is used, then only y would be incremented. Here first I am incrementing it, and only then I am using the incremented value in the expression computation, which is, and same is here, is pre-decrement. That means decrease the value first and then add one to it, and again use the value first, then decrement it. So you can probably look at how that will happen. I can probably say here, if you look at the value here, what I'm doing is x, I'm incrementing value of y, pre-incrementing it. So value of y used would be 200, it becomes 201. And then the value 201 would be used, add one to it, so x would become 202. Now I'm saying use the value of y as it is, which was 201. Use that value, so 201 plus 1, 202, and y would become 202. If we print the values here, here you would see value 202 and 201, and both will see 202. Syntax error, sorry. You can see here, x is equal to increment the value of y first, which becomes 201, and use the incremented value. So pre-increment operator is first increment the value, then assign it, and then do that part. Second case, first use the value in expression computation, and then increment the value. So value of y here is 201. 201 is used. 201 plus 1 is 202, and then y incremented, so both becomes 202. Now let me ask you a different question. If I were to do the following, what do you think value of x would be? Or is this may be a bad case? Let's do this. I'm saying x becomes x plus 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 3. So when I print the value of x, what would the value of x be?
104.
103. 104. Let's write and see what happens.
103.
Yeah, why? Look, whatever is happening, I use the value of x and then use computing it, it becomes 103, and after x is incremented. So after the value is computed, it becomes 103. And after this computer, that x becomes 101. But since I'm assigning back to x, value becomes 103, whatever computed value is. So in expression computation, look at the increment. Increment value, you use either incremented after the expression is computed or before the expression is computed, and then value is incremented. But since I'm overriding it, whatever happens, there's no meaning. And so, but however, if I were to do this, in this case, value would be 104. Because first incrementing it, then assigning it, and that's the way it would be basically. But do little practice, make sure you understand. But using this, assigning x is equal to like this, would be dangerous programming. And normally, I would recommend don't get into this kind of program. Then there are conditional operators, which is Boolean, such as equal to compare two numbers, not equal to, the exclamation mark equal sign, the six operator less than equal to, greater than equal to, six operator. Now, anytime you do, the result basically becomes true or false. In C, true is a number represented as one, false is a number represented as zero. So if I were to say x is equal, assigning x is equal to 1 is to 1, or x is equal to 1 is less than 2, value would be different. So let me just indicate that. Let's say in x is equal to 1, equal to 1, and I would say f1 greater than 2. So first I'm saying 1 is equal to 1 is true. This would basically be treated as 1. And if it's non-zero value, you see x would be 1. I'm saying is 1 greater than 2? Logical lesson comparison. And since 1 is not greater than 2, this value would become 0. So when you print, value would be 1 and 0. So you see, any non-zero value is considered as true, and any zero value is considered false. And when you use any conditional part of it, then when you see the conditional operators comes into the picture. So 0 not equal to minus 1 is true. 0 greater than 1 is false. 1 greater than equal to 1 is true. So depending on how to use it, things would happen. The result is a Boolean, as I said. True is always 1 and false is always 0. And that you have to keep in mind. In the very first or second class, I introduced you to bits, the bitwise operations. So either I can bit shift left or I can do shift right. So when I do shift left, I have to specify shift by how many means or by shift by how many bits. So this is shift left operator, shift right. Shift left by 1 is effectively doubling the value, multiplying by 2, shift right by 1 is effectively halving the values, and that's what would happen. We can probably say, when I look at that, I can say x 100, shift left 1, here I can say 100, shift right by 2. So 100 shift left by 1 will basically meaning shift the bits by 1, and you effectively see when shift by 1, I'm incrementing power by 2, this would become 200, and this I'm doing right, so I'm reducing by dividing by 2, further dividing by 2, the value should be 225. But depending on how many times you go to shift left, value would accordingly be changed, and that's how the shift left and shift right operation. There's a bitwise operator. You do an and you do an or. So and basically means if I do, probably you know the truth table, but just to remind you, we look at 1 and 1 would be 0. 1 and 1 would be 1. Both bits are 1, you get 1. If any of the bits are 0, it will become 0. So we have to look at this is for the AND. If any bit is 0, answer is 0. And if we look at the OR, if any bit is 1, answer is 1. Both bits are 0. Answer is 0. So this is the bitwise AND is represented by single ampersand sign. Bitwise OR is represented by the bar sign. And so look at we are doing what. So if we look at 4, now 4 is equivalent to, if you see, 4 is equivalent to in binary 0B100. 8 is equal to 0B100. If I'm doing 4 digits, let me write in 4 digits. Now if I see I want to do AND of 0100 with 100. If I want to look 0 with 0, so if I want to write here, let me put it right if I can write that. If we look at this 0, and if I'm doing an AND, let me do an AND part. This 0 and 0 would give me 0. This 0 and 0 would give me 0. This again, because 1 is 0, you'll get 0. And third one. So when I do AND of 4 and 8, when I do AND of 4 and 8, answer should be 0. Let me run that and show it to you. So this is a bitwise operation, and you'll see answer would be 0. If I were to do OR operation, any thought what my answer would be now?
Double 1, double 0.
Let's say 10 OR with 8, what is the answer I would get? I'm doing 10 with 8 or with 8. What is the answer I would get? Can you write it into binary, do an OR operation and tell me what you get? Do a 10, do an 8. So what is my 10 if you look at? 10, this is. This was 4 here, and this was 8. what the 10 in binary would be. If I would do 10, it would be 1010. If I were to do an OR operation, anything that is 1 would become 1. If both are 0, it would become 0. And so it becomes 1010. And hence, you will basically get what is called 10 only. If I want to run it, I'll only get 10. What happens if I were to do, let's say, 12 or with 4? Is it 12 or with 6? Can you work out and tell me, when I do 12 or with 6, what is the answer you would get? So write 12 in binary, write 6 in binary, and give the answer.
Sir, 1100.
What will decimal be? 10, sir. No, it will not be 10. When I print it, what is the answer printed would be? When I run the program, what it would print? I would like to do what would be printed? Niklanjana, Likita, Lochan.
Sir.
Yeah. What would the answer be? 12 odd with 6. If you look at binary of 12, binary of 12 is 1100. And binary of 6 is 0110. So when I do the AND OR operation, what is the bit pattern will look like? When I do OR of these two numbers,
0100.
So I'm doing an OR. So wherever 1 is, you'll get 1110. This one becomes 1, this one gets 1, this 0 and 1 becomes 1. Only the last place, both are 0, so I get 0. And this number is 14. I'm using as a command for the reserve in the program. So when I run it, you see the answer 14. So to basically do good amount of practice, look at, I think I'm running out of time, so I'll stop here. We'll continue in the next class and then some other part. Any questions? Please let me know. Otherwise, you are done.